Hello, my dear children. Namaste and welcome back to yet another session of our class 10 ICSE Biology series. I'm Ambika, Master Teacher of Biology, right here at Vedantu. How are you all? I hope you've had a wonderful week, and then I hope you've all set new targets for this week. We are already in the middle of a fresh new week. Yesterday, I couldn't join you because of my respiratory infection. Today, I feel slightly better because I got a little bit of voice rest yesterday, but I did not want to miss meeting you all again for many days together, which is why I just kept all that aside. And today again, I'm back with yet another chapter that many of you wanted to be discussed in our sessions. Okay, so we are well into the human physiology unit, as you all know. And we are done with the circulatory system and a couple of major topics of the chapter excretory system. And I understand that many of you have been wanting sessions on the endocrine system and the reproductive system. So I thought it would be a good idea to pick up endocrine system for the next few sessions. And we are starting off with that chapter today. Okay, so let's not waste any more time and get started with a positive frame of mind. The expert in anything was once a beginner. So just in case you think that you cannot match up to what experts in a lot of fields are or have been doing, just get rid of all your negative thoughts, because just remember that nobody was born an expert in anything at all. We are born with a lot of innate abilities, but expertise in anything comes only with practice. Practice makes perfect, right? That stands true for everything and everyone. So keep this in mind. You can also be an expert in anything that you deeply desire for or wish for, as long as you keep working very, very hard, and there is persistence and the willpower and the strong desire to succeed. That is all that matters. Okay. And let us look at the homework question that I had given you in the last class. Can glucose be found in the urine of a healthy person? Explain your answer. And I got answers from some of you, and these were a couple of the best answers that I got. One was from Ayush Sharma. Ayush, thank you very much for sending me an answer again. Basically, no, but if a normal person will take high level of glucose for 1 to 2 days, so Ayush has gone into explaining too much of details. 0.6 to 1% glucose might be found in his or her urine. Otherwise, all the glucose is reabsorbed by the peritubular capillaries from mainly PCT. We saw that reabsorption, right? Tubular reabsorption mostly happens in the proximal convoluted tubule or the PCT. And because of that, in a normal healthy person, if reabsorption happens normally, glucose will not be found in the urine because it gets reabsorbed back into your bloodstream. Okay, now the next answer is from Aparijita, who has also given me a similar answer but in different wordings. Glucose is not found in the urine of a normal healthy person. It's only found in the urine when blood glucose levels are raised due to diabetes. Ayush has also mentioned that when your blood glucose levels are high enough, glycosuria occurs because your kidneys cannot stop glucose from spilling over from the bloodstream into the urine. Okay, so Ayush and Aparijita, thank you very much. And the rest of you also who gave me the correct answer, thank you very much for being so active. Looking forward to hearing a lot more good answers from all of you. So stay with me till the end of this session. The endocrine system is also a very, very interesting and an important system of your body. So let us look at easy ways of understanding it. Today's session will not be very long. We will only be looking at one small part of the chapter. Okay, but Before we start, as I always keep telling you, if you have been enjoying our ICSE series, our ICSE sessions, do remember to hit the like button right now. Before you forget, do remember to share it with all your friends and subscribe to our channel. Very importantly, subscribe to our channel Vedantu 9th and 10th, because we have a lot more coming your way. Your chemistry sessions will also start very soon, so to make sure you don't miss out on anything that we have in store for you, it's very important to stay tuned, subscribe to our channel and hit the bell button so that you get all the notifications. All right, so let's go ahead. Have a look at this. What is it that this image is showing you? It's basically growth, right? So there are a lot of factors that are involved in growth, but just observe it for now. I will ask you my question at the end. I have two or three more images to show you. You need to tell me what is common in them. Growth. This is pregnancy. And you must have heard of women, if you have elder cousins, elder sisters, or somebody in your family who you have seen through their pregnancy months when they were expecting a baby. They may suddenly have strange cravings, that and many other symptoms that were never part of their normal self, right? I have also experienced this when I was expecting my baby. A lot of strange things happen, nausea, vomiting. For some of them, nothing at all happens. Everything goes on fit and fine until the very end. So those people are definitely blessed. But whatever it is very common that a woman experiences a lot of strange things during her pregnancy, okay? Then, what about this? This I'm sure you will be able to relate to very well, because you are also a teenager. You are between 14 to 16 years of age, right? Around 15 years of age. So a lot of you might be experiencing this. Why do I suddenly have so many pimples? And those of you, the guys, the boys out there, you might be suddenly noticing a change in your voice. You may be noticing that your vocal cords suddenly are feeling different, and you yourself are sounding different. Your voice sounds more bassy and less feminine as compared to what it was probably a couple of years ago, right? Why does all this occur? And this is also another one that you must have heard of, elders in your family complaining of diabetes. Right? You must have certainly heard of that. High blood sugar levels is what diabetes, the most common type of diabetes, is due to. And then apart from diabetes, these days we see that thyroid disorders are very, very common. Among young adults, it's extremely common. Some teenagers also have it. And I think women are more prone to thyroid issues as compared to men. Okay, so why does all this happen? And sometimes you may end up feeling so stressed. So many strange things can happen at different stages of your life. Why does all this happen? That is what we are going to look at in this particular chapter. This guy says, I said, my hormones are playing up again. Why don't you pay attention? Right? So this is again another well illustrated image by Cartoon Stock. I found it very nice. So the key word here in this cartoon is the word hormones, if you can see. Now, hormones are basically chemicals in your body that are the culprits, that are to be blamed for everything that we have seen so far. Blamed or praised. Like, for example, growth is a good thing, right? So there you can just say, you can just praise hormones. But then for all the issues like diabetes, the thyroid issues, the strange cravings, the negative kind of cravings that a pregnant woman might have, and pimples or acne caused on your faces or on your body, you can put the blame on these chemicals called hormones. So you can define them this way. Hormones are basically chemical messengers that are secreted directly into the blood. Okay, very, very important, because they are different from the messages that your nerves or your neurons carry. This is why we say it's important to highlight that particular point, secreted directly into the bloodstream. directly into the blood, which carries them to the organs and tissues of the body to exert their function. So basically, a hormone gets secreted from some part of your body, okay, some very important part of your body. It pours its secretion into the bloodstream. The bloodstream would flow and carry it to a target organ, okay, a target organ or a target tissue. And finally, at the target tissue or the target organ, the effect will be seen. Okay, this is what it does. So who are these? The organs that secrete your hormones, we call them your glands, the endocrine glands. And this system, okay, this system in which your endocrine glands and hormones function together is what you call the endocrine system. Okay, in the human body, these are the major endocrine glands. But before that, it's important to understand that endocrine glands, just in case you're asked to define endocrine glands, keep in mind that the term endo is important here. It means from an organ directly into the bloodstream, and not into any other tissue or organ at first, or not through any other means, or not through any tube or duct. On the contrary, the opposite of endocrine would be exocrine gland. Exocrine glands are those that pour their secretions at their target organ through a duct or through a tube. If this is an exocrine gland, it needs the help of a duct to pour its secretion. Whereas endocrine glands or endocrine parts of your body directly pour it into the bloodstream. They do not need the duct, which is why endocrine glands are also called ductless glands. Okay, children, so this is important to remember. And look at this. These are the major endocrine glands. You have the hypothalamus and the pituitary, which are part of your brain, but they act as endocrine glands in your body. Then you have the thyroid gland, which is somewhere around your neck region, the thymus gland, the adrenals, pancreas, which are found, the adrenals, which are part of the kidney itself. You find them one each on the top of each of your bean-shaped kidneys, the pancreas, which is a leaf-shaped organ, and then the ovaries in women and testes in men. Okay, all of these are the major endocrine glands in your body. Now let's look at them one by one. This is again a more serious image of what I was trying to say. This is the female and this is the male. You can also see something that's called the pineal gland. You know, something very interesting. It is said that Indian women wear a bindi or a sindoor because it helps activate the pineal gland. I'm not sure how far that's true, but they say it's been scientifically proven. Okay, that is what the pineal gland is. It's right here. This is a pituitary gland and the hypothalamus, the location of that, thyroid and parathyroid, thymus, pancreas, adrenals, ovary, and placenta, which will be a term that we discuss in the chapter reproductive system. The only difference between the male and female that you see here would be in the reproductive parts, the testes or the testicles and the ovaries and the placenta here, of course, in the females. Okay, but don't get overwhelmed by the number of terms that I'm telling you in this. According to your ICSE syllabus, there are just four major glands that you have to learn and understand. And those are your pituitary gland, your thyroid gland, the pancreas, and the adrenal glands. Okay? So these are the four major ones. And in today's session, we will be talking only about the pituitary gland. Okay, children, so stay with me till the very end. The next few minutes are very, very important, because if you pay attention to me in the next few minutes, you will be able to answer any question that comes up from this topic, pituitary glands, because that, in fact, forms a major chunk of this chapter. Okay, the remaining three are relatively simpler because it will be easier for you to relate in terms of how your body functions due to its effect, etc. But pituitary has a little more complexity because it's one of the most important glands in your body. We will look at that very soon, what makes it so special. So this is the VIP we are talking about, our today's hero. Our hero for the day is the pituitary gland, the pink shaped structure that you see here. It in fact hangs down as a very tiny structure from the base of your midbrain. You have the forebrain, midbrain and the hindbrain, right? From the base of your midbrain, this structure hangs down, and just above it you find a structure called the hypothalamus. Okay, hypothalamus is also a very important part, but we will be less focusing on that because it's not part of your syllabus in grade 10. Now let us look at what are the hormones that the pituitary gland secretes, right? Just like any other endocrine gland, the pituitary gland has its own set of hormones. What are they and what do they do? That is what we need to understand right now. Okay, so if you just have a look at it, you will see that the pituitary gland, the small pink shaped structure slightly enlarged here to make it easier for you. You will see that the pituitary gland has two lobes. Okay, it's got two lobes. One is called the anterior lobe. Okay, this part of it is called the anterior lobe. And this part of it is called the posterior lobe. Okay, and now why have I mentioned this above the pituitary gland? It's basically because although we are talking about the pituitary gland as the very first gland in the body, the pituitary cannot function without the help of the hypothalamus, which is also part of your midbrain, okay, and is yet another endocrine gland. So what it does is your hypothalamus has got indirect control through release of regulatory hormones. It controls the anterior pituitary through the release of its own hormones. Basically, what I'm trying to tell you is hormones secreted by the hypothalamus, these hormones, it's okay, you don't have to remember these names. These hormones secreted by the hypothalamus are regulatory hormones. They act as switch on and off points to activate the anterior pituitary's hormones. Okay, only if there is a trigger from the hypothalamus would the anterior pituitary be able to secrete its hormones. If that trigger is not there, it doesn't secrete its hormones. Okay, similarly in the case of the posterior pituitary, there is a neuron or sensory control based on the nervous systems. Your brain sends signals, and based on those signals your posterior lobe decides whether or not to secrete its hormones. Okay, so anterior pituitary is under hormonal control of your hypothalamus, posterior pituitary is under neural control. Okay, so understand that much for now. Basically, as a summary, just crisply remember that the pituitary, the switch on and off point of the pituitary gland is the hypothalamus. Okay, now next comes the most important question that we have to really understand from an exam perspective. What are the hormones that the anterior and posterior lobes of your pituitary secrete? The anterior lobe of the pituitary gland secretes a hormone called ACTH. ACTH is, the expansion of ACTH is adrenocorticotropic hormone. Adrenocorticotropic hormone, okay, ACTH, that is what it is. Okay, what does it do? It basically acts on your adrenal cortex, a part of your adrenal gland. Just understand that much for the time being. Okay, ACTH, like the name indicates, if you actually remember the expansion, you will be able to remember its function also. Adrenocorticotropic hormone. it activates or acts on your adrenal gland, specifically speaking, your adrenal cortex. Okay, the second hormone that the anterior pituitary secretes is TSH or thyroid stimulating hormone. From the name, tell me what it does. Thyroid stimulating hormone. Yes, it basically stimulates your thyroid gland. Okay, like the name, like the image shows you, it stimulates or acts on your thyroid gland. The third one is called growth hormone. Yes, again, the name tells you growth. We have seen an image of that also, right? It's the growth hormones that play a very, very important role in your body. So why is it that you don't grow after a certain age, after about 17, 18 years of age? A normal human being stops growing in height, at least. Right, you may tend to gain weight, you may tend to lose weight, but that's because of different other reasons. But in terms of height, at least, this stands true. Why is it that growth hormone doesn't function? It's because it's most active only until that particular age. In case it continues being active even after that, it can lead to a lot of other abnormalities, which we will see very shortly. Okay, so it acts on the liver, which further secretes its own secretions. So growth hormone for growth. And then the next one is PRL, which is the short form for a hormone called prolactin. PRL, which acts on the mammary glands. Pro is to start or activate. Lactin, lacto, anything to do with milk. Like, right, you must have heard of lactose intolerance or something like that. Lactogen, which is a baby food supplement. So anything that's associated with milk is what lacto is. So that gives you the hint, prolactin acts on your mammary glands. FSH, the full form of that is follicle stimulating hormone. Follicle stimulating hormone, FSH. What does it do? What follicle does it stimulate? Of course, the name tells you it stimulates some follicle, but where does that happen? It works in the testes of males and in the ovaries of females. You will get a much better understanding of these when we discuss the chapter human reproduction. Okay, so hold on until then. For now, understand FSH works on the testes and the ovaries respectively. The next one is called luteinizing hormone or LH. Okay, luteinizing hormone, abbreviated as LH. That is again something that works on or acts on the testes and the ovaries respectively. Again, a much better idea of which you will get in the next chapter, reproductive system. Another one is MSH or melanocyte stimulating hormone, and that acts on your skin. You must have heard of the melanin pigment, right? At least I think in some TV commercial, in some fairness cream or fairness lotions commercial, I remember the word melanin being mentioned. Melanin is basically a pigment in your skin. And the secretion of that is controlled by these hormones, like melanocyte stimulating hormone. Melanocyte is the cell that secretes melanin. And melanin, the more you have melanin in your skin, the darker your skin tends to appear. The less you have melanin in your skin, the fairer it tends to appear. Okay, so that is what MSH is. It acts on your skin, on your melanocyte. Now, that is about the anterior pituitary. Okay, just summarizing once again, anterior lobe of your pituitary gland secretes ACTH, TSH, the GH, PRL or the prolactin, follicle stimulating hormone and luteinizing hormone along with MSH. Okay, MSH is perhaps a less significant hormone. The others have a much more important role to play, but even then it's useful to remember the names. Now coming to the posterior lobe. Okay, we have just two hormones secreted by the posterior lobe of your pituitary gland, which are oxytocin and ADH. ADH, the full form of ADH is anti-diuretic hormone. It's otherwise known as vasopressin. Okay, now oxytocin, what it does is, in females, it's most important during labor, during delivery, when because it helps in causing contractions so that the baby can be pushed out and expelled out into the new world from the uterus at the end of pregnancy. Okay, and it also acts on the mammary glands and helps in lactation, in production of milk by the mammary glands. And ADH, antidiuretic hormone, think of the name, antidiuretic hormone. Diuretic is something to do with your urine secretion. So it basically acts on your kidneys. What it does is it retains water by your body. Antidiuretic hormone, also called vasopressin. Okay, so that's basically it. Whatever else I have here are secretions of the respective target organs. Okay, this is what I was saying. The pituitary gland, in fact, connects so many different parts of your body. Not exactly connects, but it has got a connection with so many different parts of your body, right? The adrenal gland, the thyroid gland, your bones, muscles, and other tissues for growth, and then your reproductive glands, mammary glands, the skin cells, the uterus, and then the kidneys, so many different things. Because it has the ability to control the hormonal secretion of all these glands, the pituitary gland is also known as the master gland. Okay, it is the pituitary which is called the master gland. Now, a question can arise. Why is it that the hypothalamus is not called the master gland? Because isn't it the hypothalamus that controls secretions by the pituitary? The question completely makes sense, but the fact here is that hypothalamus is only the switch on and off of the master gland. The master is the pituitary because it is what is in touch with all these organs. All of these organs, in fact, are endocrine glands and they can secrete their respective hormones. But whether or not they secrete it is decided by the hormones secreted by your pituitary gland. Okay, it can either activate it or it can deactivate it. This is why the pituitary gland is the master gland and the hypothalamus is a switch on off. A switch on and off button of your master gland. Okay, understand that much for now. Anterior pituitary, posterior pituitary. Posterior pituitary, just two hormones, oxytocin and vasopressin. And anterior pituitary, all of these hormones that we see here. Okay, children, now going ahead, now that we have looked at the names of so many different hormones, let's have a look at what exactly they do. Some of them are self-explanatory. The name tells you all of it, but just summarizing it in the form of a table. Once again, children, I think I've told you at the beginning of our series that for a chapter like endocrine system, creating a table is very, very important. Without this, it becomes very difficult to revise or recap. Okay, just have a table. I can also give you a sample by the end of our chapter, and then we can all work on that together, just to give you some inspiration on how to do it. Okay, so this is just an example wherein I have put the name of the hormone, the abbreviation, and its function, what it does. Okay, growth hormone, or human growth hormone, like the name indicates, stimulates the growth of bones, cartilage, and muscle, and the timing and amount released determines body size. What I mean by timing is, like I said, perhaps around the age of 17-18, after that growth hormone is not secreted in as much quantity as was during your growing years. In a growing child, from your birth until about your late teens, a lot of growth hormone should ideally be secreted. If not, there will be disorders, which we will see very soon. Prolactin, this stimulates breast development in females and it promotes and maintains lactation, which is production of milk by the mammary glands after childbirth. Okay, next one is adrenocorticotropic hormone or ACTH. What does it do? It regulates the activity of the cortex of the adrenal gland. Exactly what the name tells you. Adrenocorticotropic hormone. And remember children, tropic in biology, wherever you hear the prefix tropic, tropos or tropic, it means it is stimulating something. Okay, so adrenocorticotropic hormone. And then thyroid stimulating hormone, like I said, it stimulates the production and release of the thyroid hormones. Then FSH causes the formation of ovarian follicles in your ovaries and stimulates them to produce estrogen, which is a hormone produced by your ovaries and stimulates sperm development in men, in human males. Luteinizing hormones, there is a slight spelling error here, it has to be EI. Luteinizing hormone initiates ovulation, which is basically production of eggs or production of ova, and it also maintains corpus luteum. Now, in case you don't know all these terms, do not worry, by the end of next week, you will be familiar with all of this because we will be talking about it in the chapter reproduction. Okay, then LH also regulates testosterone production in males, which is basically the male sex hormone. Females, it's estrogen, and males, it is testosterone. LH stimulates testosterone production in males. Okay, these are the broad functions of the anterior pituitary hormones. Okay, so like I said, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 6 major of them, and then there is MSH also, which is less significant. These 6 are the most important ones. So when you create a mnemonic, let's see who comes up with the best one. Make sure you include only these, just to avoid confusion and just to make it uniform. Just these 6 hormones. Okay. Going on, let's look at the posterior pituitary hormones. We have 2 posterior pituitary hormones, oxytocin and vasopressin. Oxytocin abbreviated this way, vasopressin also called ADH or antidiuretic hormone. Oxytocin, yes, triggers uterine contractions during childbirth, during labor, and ADH promotes water retention by your nephron tubules or your kidney tubules so that it makes your urine more concentrated. That is what antidiuretic hormone does. Okay, now this is just to summarize whatever we have done so far. The posterior pituitary, and this is the anterior pituitary, and the respective hormones that they secrete. Too much or too less of these in your body can cause problems. Let us look at them one by one. Okay, this is just the table summarizing your anterior pituitary disorders, the disorders caused due to over secretion or under secretion of your anterior pituitary hormones. The first one, growth hormone. I think you can think of it by common sense. If there is too much of growth hormone in your body, what happens? Of course, the person ends up appearing very gigantic. So it results in a condition that we call gigantism. And in an adult, after becoming an adult, in case there is excess growth hormone secretion, it results in a condition called acromegaly. Now, acromegaly is basically a condition wherein the person has huge jaws. Okay, the jaws here, especially the lower jaw, grows too much and the chin seems projected out too much. And decreased levels of growth hormone obviously would cause the opposite. In a child, if growth hormone is not secreted in sufficient amounts, it can cause the child to become a dwarf, causing a condition called dwarfism. And in an adult, if there is less growth hormone, it can cause lethargy and premature aging. The person can end up aging much faster than he or she would in a normal case. Okay, just have a look at these pictures. These two are normal people. This is a giant person, a gigantic person, and this is a person who is a dwarf, suffering from dwarfism. And this is what the condition acromegaly is. Acro means jaws, and mega or megaly is enlargement. So acromegaly, enlargement of your jaws. All of this as a result of the growth hormone, either over secretion in these two cases or under secretion in the dwarfism case. Okay, now going ahead, the next hormone is ACTH. Increased levels of ACTH can cause a disease which is called Cushing's disease or Cushing's syndrome. What exactly is it? Cushing's syndrome is a condition wherein, due to excess adrenocorticotropic hormone, there is your pituitary is basically exerting too much pressure on your adrenal cortex. So the steroid hormones that your adrenals produce would be too much in quantity, too much in amount. Because of that, you would find all of these symptoms. The most commonly seen symptoms are the moon phase, personality changes, yes, but the moon phase is one of the most obviously seen symptoms in such a person. Fat deposits on the face and back of shoulders. How do you visualize that? Name of the disease is Cushing's disease. So something like a cushiony fat deposit forms around the back, the shoulders, and all other parts of the person's body, the anterior parts of the person's body. And yes, the skin would appear very thin, because of which you can actually see purple stripes or striae, perhaps the veins that are showing up, and the person ends up becoming very brittle or easily prone to injuries and bone breakage. Okay, so those are also side effects. And there may be other symptoms that you can see here, like hyperglycemia, the central nervous system, irritability, fluid retention or edema, swelling because of fluid retention in the body, and so on. Okay, these are the most common symptoms of Cushing's disease. Most importantly, remember Cushing, think of it as a cushion, and then you will be able to recall this particular image. So this is as a result of excess ACTH, over secretion of ACTH. What if there is under secretion of ACTH? That would cause something called Addison's disease. Okay, what happens here is, because there is less ACTH secreted, your adrenal glands or your adrenal cortex becomes less active. So there is not enough steroid hormones that your adrenals secrete, causing all of these symptoms like hyperpigmentation of your skin, like vitiligo, the white patches that you find on some people can be as a result of ACTH under secretion. And then adrenal crisis, like I said, underactive adrenal glands, and they don't produce sufficient steroid hormones. Low blood pressure, weakness, weight loss, all of these can happen as a result of less steroid hormone secretion, which is in turn because of less ACTH secretion. Addison's disease, opposite of Cushing's disease. Okay, now, so we are done with the growth hormone and ACTH. What about thyroid stimulating hormone, TSH? This also, an increased level of TSH will cause your thyroid gland to be overactive. Your thyroid gland is basically important to maintain your metabolism, your body's metabolism. If there is too much of TSH in your body, these symptoms can be seen. One of it is goiter. You must have learned from your lower grades, right? The swelling or enlargement that you would see in the affected person's neck area. Increased body mass ratio, increased heart rate, increased blood pressure, and something called Graves' disease. We will look at that very soon. Decreased levels of TSH would cause the opposite of all of this. Decreased body mass ratio, decreased heart rate, decreased blood pressure, and a disorder called cretinism, especially in children. Now, what is Graves' disease? What is cretinism? What is goiter? These are probably the new terms that you see here, which we will see through images. This is what goiter is. It's a thyroid related issue wherein the neck area appears swelled up. It can occur because of iodine deficiency, because iodine is an important component of the thyroid hormones in your body. Okay. Now, this is what The major symptom of Graves' disease is bulging out eyes, eyes bulging out, which is also called exophthalmia. Okay, that is the major symptom of Graves' disease, because of which your thyroid gland can become overactive and cause over secretion of its hormones. Okay, and under secretion of thyroid stimulating hormone, especially in children, can cause a disease called cretinism, wherein the child ends up having stunted growth, doesn't grow normally. He or she may end up having mental retardation also. Now, not just a deficiency in the child, this can also come as a result of the mothers. When a mother is pregnant and she is expecting a child, if she has a thyroid deficiency, the child can end up having cretinism. This is why it's important for pregnant mothers to get their hormone levels checked very often. Okay, so goiter, cretinism, and Graves' disease. Graves' disease because of excess TSH, cretinism because of under secretion of TSH. Okay, now we are done with these three, and then prolactin. If there is an increased level of prolactin, it can cause amenorrhea, which is a condition where a female does not have normal menstrual cycles. Lack of menstrual cycles, in fact, can be seen in amenorrhea. And prolactin, if it's secreted in very less quantities, it can secrete too little milk. Obviously, because the role of this hormone is to improve or stimulate milk production during lactation. If it's not secreted in sufficient quantities, there will be too less milk in the case of a lactating woman. FSH, the main problem that it would have would be when it is secreted in decreased amounts. Increased amounts, it somehow balances out with the action of the hormones that it will further activate. We'll look at that in the next chapter. But if there is little FSH or less FSH that is secreted in a person, it can lead to late puberty or infertility. Okay, delayed puberty. Normally, a human being would attain puberty around the age anywhere between 11 to 14, 15 years of age. But it can get delayed in a person who has low levels of FSH. Right, and infertility can also result wherein the person doesn't have the ability to produce young ones, whether male or female. The person becomes infertile or sterile. That can also be a side effect of low FSH. Okay, and LH, again, because it is concerned with the reproductive system, it can cause issues with the menstrual cycle, and low levels can cause amenorrhea in females and impotence in males. Okay, so these are the major disorders that can be caused as a result of the anterior pituitary hormones. Okay, children, keep in mind this table is very, very important. So just note it down somewhere and keep revising it, because it can get confusing. Under secretion is what, over secretion is what, and so on. But fortunately, in most cases, the name is self-explanatory. So if you just think logically, you will be able to answer it correctly. Now let us look at what happens to the posterior pituitary hormones, the disorders by posterior pituitary. If there is an increased level of oxytocin in a person's blood, it can activate childbirth, quicken the process of childbirth or labor, the process we call parturition, and it can result in excess milk production in the lactating mother. Whereas if she has less of oxytocin at the time of delivery, it can cause prolonged childbirth and diminished milk production. Okay, so that is an effect of oxytocin. So keep in mind, children, these two are related. Childbirth and lactation are related. It is because of the effect of oxytocin. Sorry, childbirth and lactation are related because of the effect of oxytocin. And then vasopressin, there is a small typo here. It's only a single S. Okay, vasopressin, obviously antidiuretic hormone, is supposed to make the urine more concentrated. If there is too much of antidiuretic hormone or vasopressin, It would result in increased blood pressure, a decreased urinary input and edema, which is where excess water retention happens in your body and you see swellings in different parts of your body because of that, okay? And then decreased secretion of ADH can cause a type of diabetes, which is called diabetes insipidus, okay? And then it can cause dilute urine because there is very little ADH. There is nobody to retain the water in your kidney tubules and hence the urine becomes very dilute and increased urine output, which is obvious. So just keep in mind, what does anti-diuretic mean? And then you will be able to answer these two correctly. Okay, no confusion in that. Okay, children, so now that we have seen the disorders and what hormones are secreted by your anterior and posterior pituitary, let us look at, let us have a very quick quiz time, a very, very short one, to see how much of it you remember. Cretinism is caused by a deficiency of, yes, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go. The answer is TSH. A deficiency of TSH can cause cretinism in children. Diabetes insipidus is caused due to under secretion of, we just saw that last. So you have to remember this, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go. And yes, the answer is vasopressin or ADH, anti-diuretic hormone. Which of these is caused by an increase in ACTH, adrenocorticotropic hormone? When you get a question like this, your thought process should be that, what is the expansion of that? Adrenocorticotropic hormone. Yes, ma'am said tropos is stimulate. What does it stimulate? It stimulates the adrenal cortex, adrenocorticotropic. So if it stimulates the adrenal cortex, what happens? Adrenal gland becomes overactive. If the adrenal gland is overactive, excessive steroids secreted in your body. So what happens? Yes, the person becomes very chubby and cushiony and ends up having a moon face, and the disorder is called Cushing's disease. Yes, children, under secretion is Addison's disease. Okay, I hope you have understood that. So before winding up, let me remind you, in the next session, we shall be having a quick recap of this plus the next three major glands that you have to learn. So do stay with me in that, but do not forget to download Vedantu's learning app. Stay in touch with us through the Telegram group. And most importantly, if you have understood everything about the pituitary gland from today's session, do hit the like button, share it with all your friends, and do remember to subscribe to our channel Vedantu 9th and 10th. Because we have a lot in store for you in the days and weeks to come. And in the meantime, I would be very, very happy to hear any of your feedback, any concerns you have about the session, or anything positive you want to say about the session, anything at all. Either put it in the comment section below or send me an email at my email ID ambika.gopalakrishnan@vedantu.com. And until we meet again with the second part of the endocrine system, this is Ambika signing off, and goodbye.